Hello, friends. Welcome back to another episode by Engineering Today, and hope you had a great week so far. While waiting for the weekend, let's go through some interesting space updates. We'll begin with a new SpaceX contract, followed by Elon Musk's comments on how the Rvac Raptor can be tested on the ground without explosion, and we'll wrap up with Poland joining the Artemis Accords. Let's get started with our first update about SpaceX and UAE's new space contract. SpaceX and the United Arab Emirates (UAE) Space Agency have signed a contract together to launch a domestically built Earth observation satellite. The satellite will be launched on a Falcon 9 rideshare. This satellite, MZB-SAT, will be the second domestic imaging satellite built by the UAE itself. The spacecraft has been equipped with several upgrades, including its resolving power. MBZ-SAT is an advanced domestic spacecraft and is based on similarly sized spacecraft from the US and Europe. The first flight-worthy satellite will easily cost at least $100 million. The new mission can turn out to be a milestone in SpaceX's SmallSat rideshare program. The program actually charges a minimum of around $1 million to launch around 200 kilograms on a single payload adapter. Goods beyond that mark also cost the same. Thus, if the payload is double, so will be the price. The company also offers services like fueling, and the customers are given a choice of buying SpaceX-built adapters or other mechanisms. They can also bring their own. For spacecraft weighing between 50 kilograms to 500 kilograms, the concept of buying from SpaceX is what makes the SmallSat program ideal. Third-party launch service providers like ExoLaunch and Spaceflight purchase several hundred kilogram slots for their adapters, and these are capable of hosting very few CubeSats and NanoSats. The way SpaceX has devised the program, it's much similar to its large-scale shipping programs. The company will allow the customer to decide how to strategize the usage of their containers. Some parties might require the major portion of the container, whereas some might barely use it. The latter set of parties can either find other partners or third-party companies that might be willing to work with them in order to minimize the shipping cost as well as maximize the efficiency. If everything goes as per plans, needs and budgets of the customers can all be provided with the same program during the same launch. That also includes the MZB-SAT. The MZB-SAT can be devised as an ultra-expensive vehicle demanding special care and also will have an entire container. SpaceX will try its best to include UAE's specific needs and will also take care of the duration between MZB-SAT and the transporter mission's other payloads. Now the UAE-based spacecraft is set to be launched by 2023. Finally, SpaceX and its Falcon 9 rocket have shown how the best industry pricing and the most reliable rocket together can turn out to be an unbeatable combination. Our following update is regarding the way through which SpaceX made the static fire of Rvac Raptor on ground without explosion. We know that last week, on the 21st of October, SpaceX teams carried out the static fire of the Raptor engines of Ship 20. Reports have stated that the test firing in South Texas had lasted only a few seconds, and also the test has appeared to become successful, clearing one of the several steps to be done before attempting for an orbital test flight. As we know now, this flight test may happen within the first quarter of 2022. In this time, SpaceX teams have fired a vacuum-optimized Raptor engine, which is installed inside the Ship 20 for the first time. Now, this engine was not a sea-level one, but a vacuum-optimized engine, which raised the question as to how SpaceX could test that vacuum-variant engine just a few feet above the ground, and that too without explosion. Earlier engines which got test-fired on the ground were sea-level, but this time they tested a Raptor variant, which is designed to create thrust in space. In the numerous kinds of rocket engines used over time in different spacecraft, the largest part, which helps in flow out of exhaust gas, is the engine nozzle. This exhaust gas, which generates from the combustion of propellant and oxidizer, is first made to push through a narrow passage of the engine, generally known as throat. Then the gas comes out with good thrust to propel the vehicle. Engines with larger nozzles can push out the exhaust gas at a faster rate, helping the vehicle to propel much faster. But if we look into both variants, vacuum and sea level, of engines, we'll see that not both of them have the same nozzle size. Vacuum one has a larger nozzle than the sea level one. There is a phenomenon known as flow separation, which prevents sea level engines from getting such large nozzles as the vacuum ones. According to the flow separation phenomena, the exhaust gas which comes through the engine gets separated from the nozzle walls, which creates turbulence and vibration in the engine and may lead to explosion. This case happens when the pressure of the outflowing exhaust gas falls about half below the atmospheric pressure, and it's seen that engines with larger engines are prone to this flow separation phenomenon. Atmospheric pressure in space is almost zero, thus it does not create the flow separation problem. But on Earth's surface, this scenario happens whenever the engine exhaust pressure falls. Thus, the sea level engines, which have to propel through Earth's atmosphere, have smaller nozzles to prevent this phenomenon. And to test the vacuum engines on ground, the only way is to test it inside a large vacuum chamber to avoid this phenomenon and explosion. Now, in the recent static fire test, SpaceX teams have tested out the vacuum-optimized Raptor engine, which has a larger nozzle, but the test was not carried out in any vacuum chamber but on open ground. But the test successfully ended with no explosion. This made the everyday astronaut ask Musk a question. I would love to know how they prevented flow separation when they fired a vacuum-optimized engine at sea level. Normally, the pressure at the end of the vacuum nozzle is so low that the ambient air pressure will separate the flame from the nozzle and destroy the engine, at Elon Musk. And Musk then replied, Raptor has a very high chamber pressure, which in turn allows for a large expansion ratio nozzle without flow separation at sea level. Thus, from Musk's reply, it's clear that the higher chamber pressure has saved the Rvac Raptor, while its test was done on open ground. Some sources state that Rvac variants are not fully optimized for vacuum yet, thus there was no flow separation to create turbulence and to blow it up. Now we'll end our space update with Poland joining Artemis Accords during the 72nd International Astronautical Congress ceremony. Recently, in the 72nd International Astronautical Congress, IAC, Poland has joined the Artemis Accords. This accord was announced by the United States in the year 2020 with a goal of framing up principles regarding space exploration on the basis of various space treaties. This accord was assumed to be joined by other countries to cooperate in the Artemis mission. Many countries have joined the accord. After signing, Poland becomes the 13th country to enter this Artemis Accords. As per reports, Grzegorz Roszna, president of Polish Space Agency, had signed the Artemis Accords with the NASA Deputy Administrator Pam Melroy during the ceremony to carry out safe and sustainable space exploration jointly in the future. Roszna held that this accord will strengthen their relationship with the United States and pave the way for greater cooperation in space science. He stated that Polish space companies are looking forward to developing their business outside Europe. They want to reach for new markets, especially the U.S. market. They want to participate in missions of other agencies, especially NASA. We would like to open the door for them, and I believe this is the first step, Roszna said. Melroy stated, We are thrilled that Poland has agreed to endorse the principles espoused in the Artemis Accords. These are very simple and universal principles, but they will enable the next generation of international partners for the exploration of the Moon and beyond. We thank Poland for becoming a part of this distinctive group. Melroy also favored identifying and enhancing prospects for partnerships and cooperation in space between two countries. Roszna later stated that, I look forward to even closer ties between our nations in the months and years ahead. He further stated about chances of sending a Polish astronaut to the lunar surface, but he wanted to make sure that Polish equipment, Polish instruments, will fly to the Moon and to other bodies. And I believe that this is the first step for that. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.